بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In last week's lesson, we were looking at the initial contacts between Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the people of Medina Munawwara, and I mentioned that a large group of people from the tribes of Aus and Khazraj came to Makkah Mukarramah during the days of Hajj and made a pledge of allegiance, or in other words bay'ah, with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that they were now going to worship only and solely Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that they were not going to ascribe partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, in this week's lesson, we are just going to look at the beginning part of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's migration and hijrah to Medina Munawwara, and how it all came about. Now, the same way Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's nubuwwat and prophethood came about through pious dreams and truthful dreams. What I mean by that is, before Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam became a Nabi, he was given glad tidings, he was given bushra. And the way he was given glad tidings, many of them were through dreams. That Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw dreams, and in these dreams he was given basharat and glad tidings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he was going to be chosen by Allah to represent him, i.e. be his khalifa in this world. Now, similarly, the migration and the hijrah from Makkah to Medina Munawwara also started from true dreams and from pious dreams. In terms of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would see dreams that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing him the place of migration, but not the name. So what I mean by that is, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in his dreams, he would see date palm trees. He would see sand. These are one of the characteristics or qualities of Medina Munawwara. So he would see date palm trees, he would see a lot of dates, khajoos, he would see a lot of sand and a lot of like a nice beautiful area. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was showing Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that this is where you're going to migrate to. But Allah did not say to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam which place is, the name of the place, the name of the city, but it was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showing Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam the place. Now, it's mentioned in the hadith of Sunan al-Tirmizi that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam then started pondering that where can this place be? These date palm trees, these nice sandy area, where is this? So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam thought that it could either be Bahrain or another place called Kinnis Sirin, or number three, the city of Medina Munawwara, i.e. Yathrib, known as in those days. Thereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through wahi told Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that the place of your migration is Medina Munawwara, the city of Yathrib, and this is where the order and the command came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that you now have to migrate to Medina Munawwara. Now, when the obligation and command came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam informed the Sahabas that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding all of us to migrate to Medina, that we have to leave our property, we now have to leave our loved ones. Some of us will have to leave our parents, our fathers, or our mothers who had not converted to Islam, so we have to now leave them behind in Makkah, and we now have to make our way to Medina Munawwara. Now, when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam informed the Sahabas and companions, he also told them that don't tell anyone or be secretive in your preparation of hijrah and migration. Don't let the Quraysh know don't make it obvious to them that we are now leaving Mecca and making our way to Medina Munawwara. Because if the Quraysh were to find out, they would stop us and prevent us from leaving Mecca. Now you may be thinking to yourself that how can that be possible? Because the Quraysh, they hated Islam. The pagans of Mecca, they did not like Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They did not like the Muslims. They did not like the Sahabas. They did not like the words of the Quran. They did not like the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So you probably be thinking that they will be glad that the Muslims are going. They would be glad that the Muslims are leaving Mecca and going somewhere else, so they don't have to listen to the Quran. They don't have to listen about religion. They don't have to listen about Islam. They won't see their loved ones converting to Islam on their own doorstep. They'll be happy that Muslims are leaving Mecca. Now, the reason why the Quraysh would be displeased in the Muslims leaving Mecca is not because they are going to miss the Quran. It's not that they're going to miss the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's not that they're going to miss the barakah and the khair which comes when wahi and divine revelation comes to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's not because of that. The reason why is because they would miss a punchbag. They would miss the opportunity to persecute and punish and torture the Muslims. That's what they would be sad that the Muslims are leaving. Because sometimes it happens that when a zalim, when an oppressor, when he oppresses people, when he tortures people, when he punishes people, he gets his kick out of that. He enjoys it. He likes people, he wants to see people hurt, he sees the fear on people's faces, you know, when the blood comes out from the people's arms or legs, he gets a kick out of that. It's like people, they get an enjoyment by remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they get enjoyment out of reading the Quran, enjoyment out of reading namaz. For bad people, they get an enjoyment out of swearing, they get an enjoyment out of taking cannabis, they get an enjoyment out of committing adultery and fornication. For a zalim and for an oppressor, his enjoyment, his kick is to see people suffer. His kick or his enjoyment is to see people vulnerable and, you know, seeing that fear on their faces. This is his kicks and this is his enjoyment. So the Quraysh, if they found out that the Muslims were leaving, they're going to get upset. They're going to miss that opportunity to see the Muslims suffer, going through torture, going through punishment. They're going to miss that. So therefore, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam knew about this, and he told the Sahabas that don't make it obvious. Don't let the Quraysh know that you are about to leave, you are about to migrate. Otherwise, they're going to put a stop to it. Now, when this order of migration and hijrah came, and this obviously tells us the shafqa and the love Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had for his people, that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam wasn't the first person to migrate. You're probably thinking that when this order of hijrah came, probably Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would be the first one to get on his camel or horse and then leave Mecca and go to Medina. No, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam firstly made sure that the Muslims, the Sahabas, the male Sahabas, the female Sahabas leave. And then at the end, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was one of the very last people to leave Mecca to go to Medina Munawwara. Why? Because Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is our spiritual guide. He is our spiritual father. It's like, say, for example, na'udhu billah, if there's a fire in a building, so the father, he's not going to be the first one to leave the building. He will make sure that his sons are out. He will make sure that his daughters are out. He will make sure that the young and the vulnerable are out. He will make sure that his wife is out. And then the last person to leave the house would be the father. So exactly as well, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when the order came, he didn't just like get on the camel and just, I'm out, forget about the others. Whether they make it or not, it doesn't matter. Let me go to Medina Munawwara and let me, you know, preach and so on. No, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was thinking about the rest of them. So he made sure that everybody else leaves Mecca, and then one of the last few people to leave Mecca Mukarrama was Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, the first person mentioned in the books of Sirah that the first person to leave or the first person to migrate from Mecca to Medina Munawwara was a companion in the name of Abu Salama radiallahu anhu. And I'll just mention this story just to give you an idea and a taste of Hijrah wasn't just like just get on the horse or get on the camel and that's it, you just do one. No. Hijrah was something which was very, very difficult. Abu Salama radiallahu anhu in particular, he had to leave behind his wife and his son. He was dicing with his own life. He was dicing with the life of his family members. Why? So that he can carry out this command and this ibadat and worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, I was mentioning that Abu Salama radiallahu anhu, he was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's milk brother, Razai Bai, i.e. they were breastfed by the same woman, Halima Sa'diya radiallahu anha. So Abu Salama radiallahu anhu, he wanted to migrate to Medina Munawwara. He wanted to be the first person to act upon this obligation and this command from Allah. So he got his wife, whose name was Salama radiallahu anha. And Salama radiallahu anha, remember, she later on became Azwaj al-Mutahara. She then married Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after Abu Salama radiallahu anhu passed away. So there was Abu Salama, Salama radiallahu anha, and they had a young son and a young child. So what Abu Salama radiallahu anhu did was that he got the camel ready. He made sure that his wife was sitting on the camel, his young son was sitting on the camel, and then he was just about to leave, just about to depart, when Salama radiallahu anha's family and Abu Salama radiallahu anhu's family, they all converged to the area where they were just about to leave and depart. Now Salama radiallahu anha's family firstly got a hold of Salama by the hand and they said to Abu Salama that you can do what you want, but she, i.e. your wife Salama, she is our daughter and we're not going to let you go or migrate to Medina Munawwara with our daughter. So what they did, they got hold of Salama, dragged her away from the camel and took her back to Makkah. Then Abu Salama radiallahu anhu's family then got hold of the son, the young son, and they said to Abu Salama that look, you're azad, you're mature, you're baligh, you could do what you want with your life, but this young child, he's our son, he's nabaligh, he's immature, he doesn't have any aqal, he doesn't have any sanity, he can't make a decision for himself, he is our son, he is from our tribe, so we are going to take the son. So in a matter of few minutes, you have a situation where Abu Salama radiallahu anhu, he's migrating to Medina Munawwara by himself. His wife is in one part of Makkah Mukarramah and his young son is in another part of Makkah Mukarramah. Now, normally a person, what would he have done in that situation, or a person whose iman isn't that strong, a person who may not have the intense love of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would have probably, you know, backed out in that situation. He would have said, you know what, forget hijrah, forget migrating. Let's stay back in Makkah. Let's stay with my wife. Let's stay with my young son. He needs me. But no, not Abu Salama. But Abu Salama radiallahu anhu, this situation where his wife was taken by someone, his son was taken by somebody else, he did not forsake the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But instead what he did, he just migrated to Medina Munawwara. And it's mentioned in the books of Seerah that 1 year later, Salama radiallahu anha and the young son then managed to migrate to Medina Munawwara. But this was a story of Abu Salama radiallahu anhu, who was so sincere and who really, really wanted to act upon the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this command of hijrah and migration, even if it meant that he had to leave his loved one and sacrifice his loved one, but he did it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'll just mention another story, because obviously slowly what happened was that the Quraysh and the pagans of Makkah, they found out that the Muslims were leaving slowly, they were leaving Makkah, they were making their way towards Medina Munawwara. And there's one story in particular of Abu Jahl and his crafty nature, if you want to use a slang word. Basically what happened was that there was another Sahabi in the name of Ayyash bin Rabi'ah radiallahu anhu. And Ayyash bin Rabi'ah, he and Umar bin Khattab radiallahu anhu, they both got together and they migrated to Medina Munawwara. Now Abu Jahl, he then went to Medina Munawwara and he said to Ayyash bin Rabi'ah, he said to Ayyash that look, you've migrated to Medina Munawwara, you've broken your mother's heart. like your mother is really, really upset. Obviously, his mother was not, wasn't a believer, so she's still behind in Makkah. So he's saying to Ayyash that, look, your mother's really, really sad. She's made a vow that if she doesn't see you, then she's not going to comb her hair. She's not going to leave her house. She's going to just be there. So when Abu Jahl said this to Ayyash bin Rabi'ah radiallahu anhu, so he, Ayyash bin Rabi'ah, he felt a bit sad. He felt a bit bad inside. So what happened was that he said to Abu Jahl, okay, then I'll just go back to Makkah. I'll just speak to my mother. I'll just clarify the situation and then I'll come back. Now when Ayyash bin Rabi'ah radiallahu anhu was leaving Medina, then Abu Jahl from behind, he got hold of Ayyash bin Rabi'ah radiallahu anhu. He tied his hand and then took him back to Makkah. And then obviously when he took him back to Makkah, obviously there wasn't any vow. His mother didn't make any vow. But obviously it was like his crafty nature just to like get his own back at Ayyash bin Rabi'ah, because as I was mentioning before, that he was missing, torturing and persecuting the Muslims. So he took Ayyash bin Rabi'ah radiallahu anhu back to Makkah, locked him in a house and then started, you know, beating him up and punishing him and torturing him. And it's mentioned the hadith that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam then started reading Qunut al-Nazila. Qunut al-Nazila is what we read in Fajr. And you can read it sometimes when there's a musibat or parashani. So you can read this particular Qunut where you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for dua and help. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam read this Qunut al-Nazila against Abu Jahl, against the mushrikeens of Makkah, and also prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for Ayyash bin Rabi'ah radiallahu anhu's safety and his najat. Now, as I was explaining that, slowly, slowly, the Muslims were leaving. In the droves, they were leaving Makkah. And around the Muslim-populated area of Makkah, there was this kind of eerie silence that everyone's gone, everyone's left Makkah. So the Quraysh, they got together and they basically blamed Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They said that all this is because of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's preaching this new religion, and because of this new religion, he has now caused a division and disunity amongst the Quraysh. Some are here in Makkah, the father is in Medina Munawwara, the wife's in Makkah, the husband's in Medina Munawwara, the husband's in Makkah, the wife's in Medina, the son's here, the daughter's there. So they blamed Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam for everything. Now there was a place in Makkah known as Darun Nadwa, a house where the Quraysh or where the pagans would get together and they would discuss about certain issues and they would make certain decisions in this particular house. And if you want to use a modern day example, you could say like the White House or the House of Commons or House of Lords. So the Mushrikeen's House of Lords or House of Commons was in a place called Darun Nadwa. So all the chief of Quraysh, they will get together and they will just like, you know, make a decision. They would do mashwara. They would do some consultation. So all the chiefs of Quraysh, they got together on a particular evening. And you could imagine the main agenda was, what we're going to do about this? All the Muslims, our loved ones, they've all left Makkah. They've gone to Medina Munawwara. What can we do? Who can we punish? Who can we blame? So that was like the main agenda of that particular day's meeting. Now, they were just getting together, you could say just like sitting around, getting their notes or something, getting ready for the meeting, when all of a sudden they hear a knock on the door. And this old man, he walks in. Now, this old man is actually Shaitan. He's coming, actually the shakal of an old person. So he knocks on the door and then he walks in. So everybody's looking at this person saying, who are you? Like, you know, where have you come from? Who are you? So Shaitan, obviously another crafty person, he says that, well, you know, I'm an old person from Najd and I've come here just to like listen to your mashwara, listen to your meeting and obviously give you some advice about what to do regarding this situation. So obviously they all got together, they gave mashwara. So the first mashwara they gave was, obviously because they were blaming Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam for everything. So they said, okay, the first mashwara they gave was, let's imprison Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So then this person, this old person, Ayy Shaitan, he then raises his hands and he says that, no, don't imprison Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because if you were to imprison Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then all the people from Medina will come and they will attack the prison, they will attack you and they will free Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you're not gonna achieve your aim or your objective. So then somebody else gave a mashwara and he said that let's exile Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Let's like send him somewhere else away from Makkah. So again, shaitan, he then said, well, no, if you do that, then he's going to go to another place. He's going to sweet talk them and then he's going to get another group ready. And then that groups are going to come and start attacking you. So then the third mashwara came and this came from Abu Jahl. He said that let's na'uzu billah kill Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Let's assassinate Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So you can imagine shaitan, he got happy here. So he said, yeah, this is a very good mashwara from Abu Jahl. You know, let's kill Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Let's terminate and finish Islam. So, and obviously shaitan being such a crafty person, he said to them that, you know, this is such a great deed. Let's not wait until tomorrow. Let's not wait until next week. Let's do it now. Let's finish the meeting and let's go na'uzubillah and assassinate and kill Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they all agreed and said, yes, this is a very good idea. Let's kill him now. Let's finish and terminate Islam. So they left the meeting that particular evening and their intention was now to go and kill Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, as soon as their decision was made to assassinate and kill Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Hazrat Jibreel alayhi salam, he came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he informed him what they were planning to do. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as mentioned in the hadith of Sahih al-Bukhari, he then went to Hazrat Abu Bakr radhiyallahu anhu's house and he said to Abu Bakr radhiyallahu anhu that this is now our time to migrate. As I mentioned before at the beginning, that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam made sure that the Sahabas, the weak Muslims, the vulnerable Muslims go to Medina Munawwara first. He and Abu Bakr and Hazrat Ali radhiyallahu anhu, they were the only two or three Sahabas remaining in Makkah. So he said to Abu Bakr radhiyallahu anhu that this is now our time to migrate to Medina Munawwara and we now have to leave. We have to leave now because our life is in danger if we were to stay another night here. So he said to Abu Bakr radhiyallahu anhu that we need to basically make a move and leave Makkah tonight. Otherwise, our life is going to be in danger. Now, it's mentioned the hadith of Sahih al-Bukhari that Hazrat Abu Bakr radhiyallahu anhu, because obviously he knew about Hijrah, so many, many weeks in advance, Hazrat Abu Bakr radhiyallahu anhu, he bought two camels. And he said to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that I've got two camels, I'll take one and you can use the other. Now, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam then said to Hazrat Abu Bakr radhiyallahu anhu that no, I'm not going to do that. I want to buy this camel from you. And it's mentioned in a hadith that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave Abu Bakr radhiyallahu anhu 800 dirhams to buy this particular camel. Now you may be thinking to yourself that why did Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam insist on buying this camel? You know, if somebody's giving you a camel to borrow, then why didn't Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam take it? Now the reason why, and from this we can derive another masla and a ruling, and that is that Hijrah was a great ibadat, especially at that time. You know, after Iman, the next great ibadat was migrating, was sacrificing everything, your loved ones, your family, your wealth, leaving everything behind Makkah and then migrating for the sake of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Hijrah was a great, great ibadat and a great, great worship. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to do this ibadat in such a way that he did not get any assistance or help from anyone. He wanted to do exclusively for himself, 100%, all his effort, not getting any help or assistance from anyone. And that's why scholars have said that when you are praying namaz, you should not get any help or assistance from others, even to the extent that, obviously it doesn't really apply in this day and age because we do wuzu from the taps, but in olden days, you know, sometimes there would be khadims, there would be kind of pouring the water from the lota or from the jug and then somebody's doing wudu. Scholars even said that if somebody's doing it without any reason, that is considered makruh as well. Because such a great ibadat like namaz and the wuzu, which is the key to namaz and salah, you should do it all by yourself. You should not get help from anyone. And there's many, many examples of, you know, even hajj as well. You should all do it by yourself. You shouldn't really get help from anyone. You know, other kind of ibadats like that, you should all do it by yourself. So exactly the same as Hijrah, it was a great ibadat and a great worship. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to do every single aspect of the Hijrah by himself. Even like the camel, he didn't want to use Hazrat Abu Bakr radhiyallahu anhu. He wanted to actually buy it from him so that he can say that I spent 800 dirhams in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We'll leave it there for this week. And like we said, tawfiq to atumazin said, wa akhidah.
MashaAllah.